respect for authority. And I'm going to be reading from Exodus, Deuteronomy, Leviticus, and then Ephesians. And we've come to the duty of slaves toward the duty of masters toward slaves. And we'll be looking at that. And then this afternoon, we're going to look at the pagan custom of Easter. But I'll be reading from starting from Exodus 20, verse 12. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. In Deuteronomy 5:16, honor your father and your mother as the Lord your God has commanded you, that your days may be long, and that it may be well with you in the land which the Lord your God is giving you. And then Leviticus 19:3, every one of you shall revere his mother and his father, and keep my Sabbaths, I am the Lord your God. And then Ephesians chapter 6, beginning at verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor thy father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that it may be well with thee, and that thou mayest live long on the earth. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Servants, be obedient to them that are your masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in singleness of your heart as unto Christ, not with eye service as man-pleasers, but as the servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, with good will doing service as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatsoever good thing any man doeth, the same shall he receive of the Lord, whether he be bond or free. And ye masters, do the same things unto them, forbearing threatening, knowing that your master also is in heaven. Neither is there any respect of persons with him. And we'll stop there. So we come to the duties of masters toward slaves. Last week we looked at the duty of slaves toward masters, and we discussed slavery. And today we're going to turn our attention to the duties of masters, which is also in our larger catechism, which is very in-depth. So after dealing with the duties of Christian slaves toward their masters, Paul turns his attention to believing slave masters. And I'll just read verse 9. And just note, Christian principles work in both directions. They apply to children, they apply to parents. They apply to slaves, they apply to slave masters. They apply to citizens, they apply to civil magistrates. Christian principles work in both directions. Since Jesus is the Lord over all men, the master is accountable to him and must rule in a kind, benevolent manner. And once again, these principles can be applied to parents and to civil magistrates as well. The apostle writes, verse 9, and you, masters, be the same things, do the same things to them, giving up threatening, knowing that your own master also is in heaven, and there is no partiality with him. And then the parallel passage from Colossians 4:1, masters, give your bondservants what is just and fair, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. So we know that Scripture has a number of duties that masters must obey. Let's look at them. First, Paul gives masters a comprehensive, overarching duty of reciprocation. Do the same things toward them, that is, toward your slaves. Since both are under Jesus Christ, and both are under God's moral law, both must walk in the footsteps of the Heavenly Master. Masters are to act toward their slaves with the same regard to the will of God, with the same recognition of the authority of Christ, and with the same sincerity and good feeling which had been enjoined on slaves themselves in the verses prior. Social class or wealth does not alter the moral obligations of Scripture. the tendency of pagan and secular societies to have different sets of justice for the rich and the poor does not apply to the Bible. There's no partiality with God when it comes to justice and judgment. Just as a slave is to honor his master and promote his interests, the master must honor his servant because he is a brother in Christ. He must promote his spiritual growth and economic prosperity. The Christian master is to be used by God as an agent of sanctification and responsibility in the life of the slave. Remember, we discussed biblical slavery last week. The purpose of biblical slavery is to teach men responsibility. The purpose of biblical slavery is to get people out of a slave mentality. The purpose of being a master over a slave, the purpose of slavery is so that people would become responsible citizens. They would be better Christians. They'd be better covenant members of society. He must not exhibit a pagan attitude of selfishness, which views a slave as someone merely to be exploited economically. And that's what slavery has been and continues to be in most of the world. Economic exploitation only. He's to train him for an independent life of self-government, self-discipline, and productivity. Masters must speak the spiritual good of their servants. They must be seraphims to kindle their love to religion. They must be monitors to put them in the mind of their souls. They must bring them to the pool of the sanctuary to wait till the angel stirs the waters, John 5:4. And they must seek God for them, that is, pray for them, and that their servants may be his servants. It's your goal. You want them to be a good Christian. You want them to be a godly Christian. You want them to be a good servant of society. You want them to be responsible. The put on principle that we find so much in the epistles applies to slaves and masters. Did you used to steal, Paul says? Or were you idle? Get a job. Learn to work with your hands. Learn to be so productive that you have extra money where you can help other Christians. Put off, put on. Be responsible. If employers applied this biblical principle to their employees, the workplace would be far better than it is today. There would be a concern that fathers could obey the Sabbath and spend the Lord's Day with their children. It was only 40, 50 years ago that what are called blue laws or Sabbath laws were widespread in the United States, especially in areas that had Reformed churches in them, Michigan and so forth. There was a respect for the Sabbath, out of a respect for God's word, out of respect for God's law, out of respect for Christ. That's gone. That's gone. And I've been in sales, and it's extremely difficult to find jobs where they'll not allow you to work on the Lord's Day. But we can't compromise. The employees would not simply be viewed as cogs in a wheel, but as people who need Jesus Christ and it should better themselves spiritually and economically. This is the Christian view of economics. This is the Christian view of society. Superiors would not overstep their authority, for they would recognize that it is God who makes one man to differ from another. They would run their business not as a harsh dictator, but as a benevolent servant of Jesus Christ. And once again, this applies to masters, it applies to employers, it applies to parents, it applies to the civil government. Second, masters should rule with gentleness, forbearance, and mercy, and not be overbearing, irrational, and unnecessarily harsh. Paul exhorts them to give up threatening, Ephesians 6:9. And this is especially true obviously, of the treatment of believing slaves. Leviticus 25, verse 43, talking about Jews and their Jewish bondservants. You shall not rule over him with rigor, but you shall fear your God. Slaves are not to be treated ruthlessly, harshly, or savagely. And you've all seen the pictures from slavery in the South, where men are brutalized in irons and beaten mercilessly for minor infractions. Masters have the authority to command, but not to abuse. They are not there to make the slave's life miserable or cause him to live in fear or vexation. His authority is to be enforced first by reasoned arguments from Scripture. And that should be true in the workplace, but because our nation is so wicked, because of pluralism, can you imagine if you tried to do this as a boss? You might get sued for discrimination. But if a slave is obstinate, the master does have biblical authority to impose a physical punishment. But this punishment, like everything else, is limited by God's law. Unlike pagan concepts of a master's authority, the Bible does not allow arbitrary sanctions or an autonomous determination of punishments. In Greek and Roman culture, if you beat your slave to death, no big deal. You could do that. There are God-imposed limits, judicial limits, on the master's lawful authority to impose physical sanctions. What are the limits? The first is mechanical. The bondservant must be punished with a rod, not with a lethal weapon. Okay, the master's not allowed to use a baseball bat or a sword or beat him with chains or hit him with big rocks or to knock him down on the ground and kick him. He can discipline with stripes under unusual circumstances, but not with fists and kicks and brutality. That's one limit. A second limit is that if a master beats a servant and he dies that day, the master must be executed. Leviticus 24, 21. Whoever kills any man shall surely be put to death. That would not happen in Roman or Greek society. Now, this may sound harsh to modern ears, but in the ancient world, this limitation on the master was radical. It was exceptional. It was unique. A third limit on the master's severity is the loss of a servant. You abuse your servant, it's going to cost you economically. If the master loses his temper and beats up a slave and knocks out a tooth or damages the servant's eye, that is, if he causes any permanent physical injuries, the slave is given immediate freedom. Exodus 21, 26 and 27. That's also radical. You don't find that in the ancient world, except for the Bible. Unlike pagan slavery, the ownership of the believing master over his slave was not absolute. When a pagan talks about his slave, it's a piece of property like a chair or a table. And Aristotle wrote about slavery. Aristotle said, look, a master can do no wrong to a slave because the slave is merely a piece of property. If he beats him to death, that's no big deal. That's the way Aristotle, who was a very intelligent Greek philosopher, that's how he wrote, one of the greatest of philosophers, even though he's a pagan swine. The master loses his authority and economic benefits the moment that he exceeded his God-given authority through excessive abuse. Remember, the master's authority is limited by God's law. Only Jehovah has absolute authority. That's why when David committed adultery and murder, God could say, I'm going to spare you. God had that authority. We don't have that authority. Only God has that authority. When employers, managers, and bosses treat their workers with Christian kindness, gentleness, and biblical rationality in discipline, they will not only improve productivity, but will also eliminate a large turnover and the need to retrain new workers. Now, I've worked in places with extremely nasty, mean, completely irrational bosses. And I've worked in places where the guy above him was his personal friend and would not get rid of that guy. And what happened is they had a ridiculous turnover. You go back there every 3 months and there's different employees, because after a while, people can't take it anymore. And they're all gone. And that's really bad for business. That is not good for business. Biblical principles lead to economic prosperity. They do. When employers treat people with concern and make it clear that that company is run on Christian principles, workers who are disgruntled and resentful will have a new positive attitude. Now, there's going to be exceptions to that, but that's generally true. Some unregenerate people are just wicked and have to be sent packing. While modern labor unions and uncaring corporate managers often look at each other as adversaries with goals of economic exploitation, Marxism has penetrated and infiltrated every aspect of our society. So has the theory of evolution. Unions view the master as the enemy, the owner as the enemy, the owner views the unions as the enemy. It's this conflict. While modern labor unions and uncaring corporate managers often look at each other as adversaries with goals of economic exploitation, Christian employers and employees are governed by God's moral law and treat each other as human beings made in the image of God. You don't look at somebody as a cog on the wheel, but as a person. If you look at Nazi Germany, if you look at the Soviet Union, if you look at Vietnam, if you look at Cambodia, if you look at communist China, people are viewed as, of course, it's a materialistic philosophy. People are viewed as cogs in a wheel. Stalin said, if the guy next door gets killed, it's a tragedy. If a million people are killed or murdered, it's a statistic. That was his attitude. The common criticisms of capitalism today as uncaring, exploitative, and lawless could never be leveled against Christian capitalism or free market economics under God's law. Now think about this economic crisis that we just happened, 2007 and beyond. And of course, people are blaming capitalism. It's the free market's fault. We need bigger government. We need the government to be involved in every aspect of our life. Now, of course, there, right there, you have faith in a messianic state. But the problem with the argument that it was capitalism's fault is that if you study what occurred, it was human greed and exploitation where people were being dishonest with each other and not treating each other as human beings made in the image of God with dignity. People had junk bonds and were selling junk, knowing it was junk, knowing they were ripping people off. People played the system. People ripped each other off. People lied. That is not capitalism's fault. That is people violating the moral law of God. If the moral law of God was followed, if Christian principles were followed, and the government followed them as well and stayed out of economic affairs, except to regulate the money supply and make sure people weren't printing counterfeit money and things like that, the crisis would never have happened. A master must not only avoid being harsh, but must also learn to command and encourage servants when they do well. Though a master is to tell a servant of his faults, Yet he is not always to beat on one string, but sometimes to take notice of that which is praiseworthy. Once again, it's a great civil government to do that. The magistrate, Paul says, is to praise that which is good. Today we have the opposite, where that which is evil is praised. Homosexuals are praised, lesbians are praised, transgender are praised. People who believe in theft and envy and who worship the state are praised. People who are responsible Christian citizens are condemned. So we have the opposite of what's true. But this applies to the state, it applies to the family, it applies to economics. This makes the servant more cheerful in his work and gains the master the love from his servant. So it's very wise. A parent or an employer who is excessively negative will discourage those under them and will actually reduce productivity. When I've had jobs where everything was negative and where people are not rewarded for example, I'm back many, many years ago when I worked at Sears, and I was the ace salesman in my department, but I was never promoted because they had to promote African Americans. They had to promote minorities and women. So even though I was the number one salesman, I kept getting overlooked. I just quit. What's the point? When something's worthy of praise, it should be praised. Third, masters are to rule with justice and fairness, Colossians 4:1. Masters, give your bondservants what is just and fair. Now, Paul does not mean here that slaves are to receive justice according to Roman law. That would be bad. That would not be good. But rather according to biblical law. Paul did not believe in natural law theory as it is practiced in the Middle Ages and today, or preached. This refers not only to discipline, but also to the general treatment of servants. A master is to follow the basic principle that, 1 Corinthians 9, 7-12, a laborer is worthy of his hire. Although slaves, now some got a kind of allowance, but slaves normally don't receive wages, they were not to be overworked, and their basic needs were to be met in abundance. They were to be well fed, well clothed, and given adequate shelter. Okay, the slave labor camps of the Soviet Union, the Gulag, and the Nazis were an explicit denial of the image of God in man and a repudiation of biblical law. And by the way, the slave labor camps where people are worked to death still exist today in North Korea and other places. I've even seen pictures of them. There's satellite images of the slave labor camps in North Korea. Stalinism still exists in North Korea. And of course, certain things are happening in Cuba that are quite bad as well. Their worldviews allowed them to work millions of people to death. Literally, to death. Because they did not regard their enemies as real human beings, but as vermin, as subhumans. Stalingrad, they took 110,000 men prisoners. Many years after the war, 6,000 returned. Over 100,000 starved to death in labor camps. And the Germans were just as bad. Out of 3 million Russian prisoners, less than 3% were alive at the end of the war. Less than 3%, that's pretty bad. And a lot of them were just left out in fields to starve and exposed to the elements. In addition, Christian masters must be honest with their servants and not take advantage of their position of authority over them. In the ancient world, it was common for rich landowners to defraud poor workers under their authority. Very common. And because the rich landowners were connected in society with the authorities, there was really nothing the worker could do about it. This must never happen with a Christian master or employer. Workers are to be paid in full and on time. Be very exact and punctual in the agreements you make with your servants. Do not prevaricate, keep not back any of their wages, nor deal deceitfully with them as, and here's a notable example, Laban did with Jacob, charging his wages, Genesis 31:7. Oh yeah, 7 years. Here's our agreement, 7 years. Oh, by the way, I've added another seven on. I was a cheat. That's why when Jacob left, they did not part on good terms. Falseness in promise is as bad as false weights. It's a form of theft. If an employer has made some bad decisions and is having difficulties financially, he must bear the burden, make personal sacrifices, and thus fulfill his obligations toward his workers. Now, I didn't get into this, but the bankruptcy laws in the United States are unjust. Because what they essentially do is they put the burden on the people that you owe money to. You get to rip all those people off, generally speaking, to a degree, and you get to retain all sorts of luxuries. That's simply unjust. The ancient Jews brought God's wrath down upon them because they oppressed the poor. And this is how they did it. They didn't pay him what they promised. They didn't pay him on time. Sometimes they just flat out ripped them off. And God hates that. Now this brings us to a tangential topic here that I must, when we talk about what is fair, what is just, we have to discuss briefly what left-wingers call the just wage theory. Left-wing politicians talk a lot about a, quote, just wage, end quote. And then they attempt to pass laws that force employers to pay uneducated, unskilled laborers wages that are far higher than the free market would demand. And by the way, the Roman Catholic Church in the Middle Ages had a just wage theory. They did not believe in the free market. They wanted to enforce what they consider to be a just wage, which completely messes up the free market. Now, besides the fact that such laws simply drive businesses out of business, or they force them, if you violate market principles, you're going to force a business out of business, or you're going to have to subsidize the business with statist principles, you know, taxation, where somebody steals from somebody to give to another, or you're simply going to force the businesses to relocate to Mexico or China or to an area where there's more free economic freedom. And we're seeing that. Biblical justice, by the way, in such principles, this just wage theory, it simply produces high unemployment. If a worker's really only worth, let's say, $6 an hour, and some liberal city council passes a law saying you've got to pay them $12 an hour and give them health care, and you've got a business that is a very low profit business, like you're selling hamburgers or something, or you have a janitorial service or whatever, you're simply not going to work in that area, and you can't hire workers. You can't afford it. Biblical justice, when we want to talk about a just wage, biblical justice requires an employer to pay his workers exactly what he has promised to pay. That's justice. I'm going to pay you this much an hour, and I'm going to pay you exactly that. Make sure you pay him that. If he pays less or he does not pay them on time, he is a thief. If he offers horrible pay for hard labor, he does not need the state to force him to raise wages, for the market will force him to raise wages. Do you understand that? The Bible assumes free market economics from beginning to end. He doesn't need the state to force him to raise wages. The free market will, in the end, force him to raise wages. If the wages are too low, people have the freedom to say no and walk away. Why do Mexicans and people from South America and so forth do most of the picking of fruit in the United States and vegetables? Because they want to keep wages low. They can't afford to pay Americans what Americans are willing to work to be out in the hot sun all day. They get people from other countries where those wages are better than they would get in their own country. It's a free market. So people have the freedom to say no and walk away. They don't need the state to intervene for them. They don't need the state to use coercion and get involved in things that they have no business getting involved in. The people can walk away. The owner will raise wages until the people begin to say yes. It's that simple. If I put a sign out there and I say, look, I want someone to mow my lawn for a buck an hour, I'm not going to get any takers. I'm going to have to raise the wage until somebody says, okay, that's worth it. I'll go do that. The statist just wage theory is disproved, by the way, by the parable of the vineyard, where our Lord condemns those who complain about the justness of their wages. They accuse the landowner of being unjust. Look, I started at 6 a.m. I worked in the hot sun all day long. You paid me a denarius. The guy you hired at 4 o'clock, who worked for 2 hours, you gave a denarius. That's not just. I should have got more. And they're condemned by Jesus in the parable because they had previously voluntarily agreed to work for a denarius. You see, what does that assume? That assumes a free market. That assumes that when you agree to work for something, you have to do that. If you don't want to work all day in the hot sun for a denarius, you don't have to do that. You could have said no. But the master, the owner of the company, has the right to determine a wage, and you have the right to say no. And the state has no right to interfere. By the way, that was Matthew 20, verse 2 and 13. 13, and then verse 15, Jesus said, "Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with my own things?" Which obviously demands a positive answer. It's a rhetorical question. The statists or socialists would say, no, it is not lawful for you to do what you want with your own things. Because you didn't build that. The state did. You're the state, we're the state, we own you. We really own your property. You don't own it, you rent it from us. We're going to tell you what to do with your own things. You see, the statist rejects biblical concepts of freedom and private property. And the American people are so ignorant, at least 51% of them, that they don't see the importance of this principle, to have the state play God, the state to play Messiah, and mother and father of all the people. Well, in a crisis situation, where wages fall incredibly low, and that happens in history on occasion, Christian masters and employers must make sure that their workers have adequate food, clothing, and shelter. Well, that's true. Believers must emphatically reject all forms of statism. There have been times in history, like during the Great Depression, when wages fell extremely low. And if you're going to pay somebody low wages, you better let them sleep in your house or something. You know, don't have somebody starve to death. Try to take care of them. That's what a Christian would do. That's why I say, when we talk about free market economics and capitalism, we always have to say, we believe in Christian economics. We believe in Christian free market economics. We believe in Christian capitalism. We don't believe in lawless, antinomian capitalism. Let me give you an example. I was a salesman, and I worked with salesmen who would take a woman who's 89 years old and she's going to die. she's got about 3 months to live, and sell her $25,000 for the brand new windows for her house that she doesn't really need. A Christian would never do that, but an unbeliever would. David Chilton provides a biblical approach when he says this. This is an excellent statement. Statism is thus the infringement of God's limits on the state. It is sin. Defined by the Westminster Shorter Catechism as any want of conformity unto or transgression of the law of God. For the state to fail to conform to God's law, that is, by, for example, by refusing to execute those who should be executed, for example, murderers. If you commit murder in our country, you're not executed, and I'm shocked that a lot of them get parole after a certain time. First and second degree murder. Homosexuals should be executed. Practicing homosexuals, lesbians should be executed. Practicing lesbians. Abortionists should be executed, et cetera, et cetera. And this is not being done. It is statism. Because it is the state playing God by attempting to relax God's standards. For the state to transgress God's law, for example, by interfering with the price mechanism of the market, is statism. Because the state is claiming omniscience and omnipotence over the creation. God has given the state certain legitimate and necessary functions, but ruling the world is not one of them. The state's only duty with respect to the market is to guard against and punish what the Bible defines as public crime, which, as we have seen, is not absolutely identical with sin. Let me just give you an example. If you hate somebody in your heart, that's not a crime. You can even call them a dirty word in private, and that's not a crime. If you do it in public, it might be. But if you go over and you punch them in the mouth, you've committed a crime. You may not care for the poor, as the Bible asks you to do. In the Bible, that's not a crime. It says God's going to get you. God's going to punish you for that. But it's not a crime. But if you steal from somebody, or if you promise them a wage and you don't pay it, that's a crime. There's a difference between sins that are merely sins and sins that are both sins and crimes. Hating somebody is not a crime. It's a sin. Somebody that's not, you know, like hating a brother or something, that's a sin, but it's not a crime. We've seen there is not absolutely identical with sin. I may have sin in my heart in refusing to do business with red-haired people, but it is not a crime legitimately punishable by the state. God will deal with me. Again, if my prices are, in quotation marks, too high, the search for bargains will induce people to patronize the business of a competitor whose prices more closely are in line with the reality of demand. God's imposed scarcity, Genesis 3:17-19, by that he means it's imposed because of the fall. Prior to the fall, there would not have been scarcity, and after Jesus returns, there will no longer be scarcity, induces men to become less wasteful. The free market is free only with respect to state intervention. It is never free from the providence of God, end of quote. And I would say it is never free from the law of God. Okay, so those are the major duties of masters toward servants, which once again applies to civil magistrates beautifully, applies to parents beautifully. Well, let's look now at the motive for obedience. The master is to treat slaves with kindness and justice because he too has a master in heaven. That's the central motive. When it comes to the final judgment, God is not a respecter of persons. He doesn't care whether you are the president or whether you are living in a slum in the third world. The same standard of justice, which is the moral law of God, is going to be the standard by which you are judged. From the greatest of kings to the poorest of peasants, all are accountable to Jesus Christ. All will stand before the judgment seat of Christ on that final day when Christ returns at the last trumpet, with the saints. Consequently, one must stand before the one who is all-seeing, all-powerful, sovereign, and just. Consequently, as slaves of Christ, masters must treat slaves as they would like to be treated. If you were a slave, how would you like to be treated by your master? And I'm talking about reasonably and biblically, not absurdly. All masters should keep in mind Jesus' inspired proclamation of judgment against wicked rich employers. It's James. Here's what James says. This is James 5, 1-5. Come now, you rich, weep and howl for your miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver are corroded, and their corrosion will be a witness against you and will set your flesh like fire, will eat your flesh like fire. You have heaped up treasure in the last days. Indeed, the wages. Now, this makes it clear. He's not condemning simply being rich. Abraham was rich. David was rich. Solomon was rich. There were a number of rich saints. Nicodemus was rich. He's condemning people who are rich, who are unjust. And indeed, the laborers, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, cry out. And the cries of the reapers have reached the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth. You have lived on the earth in pleasure and luxury. You have fattened your hearts as in a day of slaughter. We are all accountable to Christ. We all have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Therefore, we must make sure that we follow the moral law of God in everything that we do, and not take advantage of being in a position of authority over another person. Whether you're an elder in a church, whether you're a president or a prime minister, whether you're a slave master, whether you're an employer, it's a common practice today. This is true. This was true. It's been true for decades. It's a common practice today for employers to lie. I call it a bait and switch. They advertise a job. They tell you you're going to be doing this, and you get the job, and you find out what you're going to be doing is 10 times worse than what was advertised. Okay, fraud is common today. Well, that takes us to our final point we're going to deal with, respecting the fifth commandment, which is respect for one's elders. Respect for one's elders. The fifth commandment also involves a general respect for one's elders, that is, older people. The very young are not to be arrogant or to seek out a new path, irrespective of the religious, scientific, and social achievements of prior generations. And this respect is taught in a number of related passages. Here's, for example, Leviticus 19:32. Listen to this. You shall rise. That means you shall stand up. You shall rise before the gray-headed and honor the presence of an old man. And fear your God. I am the Lord. Care is, one is to rise in respect to honor the presence of an aged person. When we meet them in a public place, or when they come to visit our family, we must show them reverence. It's right in the Bible. Until recent years, in more than a few cultures, all rose when an older man or woman entered a room. You're sitting down and grandpa walks in. Everybody would stand up in honor. And then when he would be seated, they would be seated. People do that for the queen, and people might do that for the president, but it used to be done for all old people as an honor, as a token of respect. It is still a common practice to give the grandfather, or if widowed, the grandmother, the prominent place at the table at family gatherings. The oldest person sits at the head of the table. They're given the place of honor because they are older. Unfortunately, American culture seems to be one of the least respectful toward the aged in the whole world. If you watch a documentary about, let's say, people from Iran or people from other countries like Japan that emigrate to America, they're horrified by the way they see people treat their parents and grandparents, and they try to instill their old country's culture rather than American culture. It is also a sad fact that though our degenerate movies and through our degenerate movies and television programs, we are exporting our youth obsessed culture across the globe. A friend of my brother's went to Japan and lived there for a number of years, and he said that they're the Japanese women who are traditional, and then they're the Americanized ones who try to do everything American. And he said they're wicked. They're wicked. This is all the result of humanism, which leads to hedonism. Although all the aged are to be shown a certain respect, reverence is to be especially directed to the aged, noted for their righteousness. Here's what it says in Proverbs 16:31. The silver-haired head is a crown of glory if it is found in the way of righteousness. The gray-haired head is a symbol of wisdom, experience, and insight. To not honor and respect the older generations and our spiritual forefathers reveals an ignorant, foolish mind that will be condemned by God. You say, well, why is our culture so degenerate today? Why is art so bad? Why is music so bad? Why is literature so degenerate? Well, there's no respect for history. There's no respect for the older generations. This moral imperative is carried over into the New Testament, the New Covenant Church. Paul says this, 1 Timothy 5:1 and 2, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father. Older women as mothers. Even if he does something wrong, it's inappropriate to go up and rebuke sharply an older person. They can be corrected, but they must be corrected gingerly with respect. As an aspect of respect, the younger one is not to rebuke sharply the old, but rather respectfully admonish them when they are wrong. He doesn't say let them slide, but it has to be done carefully and respectfully. The assumption here is that the young are to regard the old as their superiors. That's the assumption. That's the assumption of the Old and New Testaments. The young are to regard the old as their superiors. That's the opposite of what we have today in America, where the young are arrogant. They don't listen to their parents. They don't listen to their grandparents. They don't listen to the wisdom of the older generations. The statement in Leviticus, I am the Lord, 19:32, tells us that showing respect to the aged is an expression of the fear of God. If you fear God, this is how you're going to treat old people, with respect, with reverence. It is a crucial aspect of Christian ethics. Now, we live in an age that worships the young, the youth culture. And almost all automatically views the old as out of touch and irrelevant. Truth and wisdom are viewed as either irrelevant or as something that happens spontaneously. The modern goal of many in our culture is perpetual youth for a life of fun, pleasures, and hedonistic pursuits. Perpetual youth. Perpetual youth, the plastic surgery industry, and so on. The philosophy of human autonomy, self-esteem, and self-actualization has resulted in a self-centered, exceptionally arrogant, historically blind youth culture. If you ever see these shows where they'll do a thing where they'll go up to people, college students, no less, college students, and they'll ask them things like, who was the president during the Civil War? And they'll say things like, George Washington. Who was Abraham Lincoln? Oh, he was our leader in World War I. People have no knowledge of history whatsoever. Most people. The depreciation of maturity in history has led to a widespread philosophy of existentialism. Okay, do what thou wilt. Just have fervor about it. Be sincere about it, but just do whatever you want. And it fits perfectly with our culture of narcissism and our culture of pluralism. Where the Republicans have Mitt Romney, a priest of a satanic cult, in a satanic cult, get up there at the Republican convention and talk about what a wonderful Mormon he was, what a wonderful caring Mormon he was, that he was diligent in spreading damnable lies to people around the globe with his missionary work. And that's supposed to help us want to vote for him. Because he served Satan so faithfully. That's existentialism. This idea that, well, he did it sincerely, he did it effectually. The fact that it was a lie, the fact that it sent people to hell is ignored. That's existentialism. It fits perfectly with our concept of pluralism. One must live in the present for excitement in the creation of one's own truth. But when children disrespect the elders and leave them to rot in nursing homes, they are a sign of a culture in decline, and that is rushing to judgment. One of the things that we are told repeatedly in Scripture is that God has a special concern for orphans and widows. And the vast majority of people who are over 80 years old are women. They're widows. God has a special concern. Now, in the old days, Christians had orphanages where young children were taught Christian ethics and were placed in Christian homes. Unfortunately, the state has taken that over. And now people are shuffled around so they can be exploited for money from the state. Certainly there are some caring families there, but I've seen a lot of it. A lot of it is simply exploitation. When Jehovah described the judgment to come upon Jerusalem and Judah, he noted some of the very same things that dominate our present culture. Isaiah 3, 4 to 5. I will give children to be their princes, and babes shall rule over them. The people will be oppressed, everyone by another, and everyone by his neighbor. The children will be insolent toward the elder, and base toward the honorable. What does that make you think of? Well, it makes me think of the 1960s in particular. But it happens throughout history. I was in a philosophy class in college where the professor read a statement, didn't tell us who it was by, and it talked about how the kid dressed sloppily and they had long hair and they were disobedient to parents. We thought it was somebody describing the situation in the 1960s. It was a Greek philosopher writing several hundred years before the birth of Christ. The lack of maturity, judgment, and wisdom that characterizes America's culture, modern evangelicalism, and our lawless civil government is a prelude to catastrophe. Who voted for Obama in great numbers? People who were ignorant and the young. People who had envy and people who unfortunately don't understand what biblical charity is. They think biblical charity is give the state power to steal from people and then turn around and give it to other people who watch television and smoke weed. The biblical reverence for the aged is not based on their fragility or weakness or upon a humanitarian basis. It is rooted in the God-ordained way that a healthy Christian society should function. The young covenant person is dependent upon the achievements of their forefathers. This is true in areas such as agriculture, science, technology, and engineering. And it is even more crucial in spiritual matters. When you're born, there's already a civilization around you. There's buildings, there's orchards, there's all the scientific achievement that other people, your forefathers, have done. The 2,000 years of church history have been a time of great conflict, where Satan has continually sought to destroy the church by perverting the gospel and other crucial Christian doctrines and practices. The person of Christ. How do you define the person of Christ? That was a huge controversy. The Trinity, another huge controversy. The doctrine of Scripture. That was extremely huge in the late 1800s and has continued up to the present. And the nature of Christian worship. These are all crucial topics. Well, there have been periods when it seemed that the devil had the upper hand. God has always preserved a remnant, and Christian doctrine has come into a much sharper focus through the many doctrinal controversies. That's why I tell you, if you really want to know theology, don't simply read a good systematic theology, a good Reformed systematic theology. Read a history of theology and learn your church history. And see how God used Orthodox men throughout history to sharpen doctrine against heresy. With this in mind, we can see how the fifth commandment applies to an attitude toward our faithful spiritual forefathers. If we find ourselves believing a different doctrine or worshiping in a new innovative manner, then we have dishonored, and I'm not using this in a Romanist way, we have dishonored Mother Church and have departed from the hard-fought attainments of the Reformation. There must be a respect for our elders. If we are to be faithful in this application of the fifth commandment, we need to do a few things diligently. First, we need to study good Protestant and Reformed Christian doctrine thoroughly. Now, you can go to church faithfully for many years, and you're going to pick up a certain amount of doctrine. But you still have to study on your own, and you have to study diligently on your own if you really want to know theology well. If one is to be faithful to the former attainments, we have to know what those attainments are. Do you know? Have you studied? One of the reasons heresy spread so quickly and easily in our day, even among supposedly conserved Reformed denominations, is that most church members have only a very rudimentary knowledge of Reformed doctrine. For example, when the Federal Vision, or the Auburn Avenue heresy, whatever you want to call it, Norman Shepherdism, when it broke upon the scene in 2002, and I was given a bunch of tapes by Joel Moorcraft to listen to, and I immediately thought, what a horrible heresy this is, and I expected to be fully condemned. I really did. I expected to be condemned in the OPC and the PCA and other Reformed denominations. I expect it to be condemned because it's clearly a denial. Now, I know they write in a way that's vague. They write in an ambiguous, equivocal way to try to deny what they're doing. But if you study it, it's clearly a denial of the doctrine of justification by faith alone for a Romanist hybrid. And it wasn't condemned. It was condemned by a few small denominations. It spread rapidly with little opposition. Whole congregations were swept away with this heresy. This doctrine of justification, which is Romanist at bottom. And they did this without losing hardly any church members. For example, Doug Wilson's church is huge. I don't know how many members it has, but it's huge. It's several hundred people. And from what I understand, they might have lost 3 or 4 families. That's it. Now, part of that, once again, is you have false shepherds disguising their doctrine and couching it in terms of orthodoxy. Heretics always do this. But if you have studied Burkhoff, if you studied Turrentine, if you studied Calvin, if you studied theology, you would know immediately that this is a deadly heresy, and you would honor the attainments of the Reformation and reject it emphatically. Covenant heads did not know enough doctrine to protect their families from a deadly, damnable heresy. Second, we must always be willing to examine our church practices, especially worship, in light of sacred scripture and in the wisdom of the church's historical testimony. Okay, I'm talking about honoring Mother Church, and I'm not using it in the Roman sense. Most Reformed churches today, for example, use uninspired hymns, that is, hymns written by men that are not canonical, and they use musical instruments in public worship. This is a radical departure from what Presbyterian churches used to do in the past. Consequently, if we are to honor our spiritual forefathers, we must look to Scripture and see if uninspired hymns are authorized. They are not. They are not. I've written about this extensively, and there's sermons. You can go to Sermon Audio and listen to them. There are no examples of anyone in the Bible writing uninspired songs for use in public worship. Every single person who wrote songs for public worship in the Bible was a prophet: David, Asaph, and others. And the book in the middle of the Bible that we are commanded to sing is the Book of Psalms. God wrote a hymn book for the church. Does the Bible authorize musical accompaniment in public worship? Well, it does, but only for Old Covenant ceremonial temple worship. Once again, if you go back and you study your Bible and you look at all the places where musical instruments are used or authorized, you had to be a Levite. If you played the two trumpets, you were a priest. And you not only had to be a Levite, but you had to be from certain families to play certain instruments. This liturgical family was in charge of the cymbals. This one played the harp, etc. There's no examples in the Old or New Testament or commands for regular believers to say, hey, you know, I like the guitar. I'm going to play guitar in church. I like the banjo. I like the piano. I'm going to play drums in church. There's nothing. There's none of that. Not only does Scripture settle the matter, and remember, we believe in sola scriptura, so Scripture always must be the argument, but the historical testimony explains how the church went astray. Men fell in love with human traditions, and they tolerated false worship for the sake of unity. False worship came into the church. This is true not only of musical instruments and uninspired hymns, but also Christmas and Easter and the church calendar. These things were practiced by some, and then it became popular in a local church, and then the session decided, well, you know, people like this. Let's go ahead and adopt this. And then the presbyteries had to decide, are we going to discipline these people, or are we going to allow local sessions to have the authority to set their own worship standards? And they opted for the latter. They opted to simply say, well, we're going to allow churches to have different practices. And thus we have today where you can go to one church and have complete charismatic style worship, and you go to another. There's a PCA church near St. Louis where you'd think you were almost in a Roman Catholic church, because there's no uniformity, because there's no longer faith in the Scriptures, and the regular principle has been rejected. If we are to obey the fifth commandment with regard to our spiritual forefathers and their attainments, we must not develop sophisticated arguments to justify current declension. And if you read articles by PCA ministers, OPC ministers, scholars, seminary professors on hymns, uninspired hymns, on musical instruments, on feminism in the church, the role of women in the church, all these things that have been perverted by churchmen over the decades, they have sophisticated arguments for their declension. When I first became a psalm singer in the late 70s, this is what really convinced me. I read everything I could find in favor of exclusive psalm, and I said, well, this is all based on the exegesis of Scripture. Then when I went and read the opposing arguments, it was people trying to justify current practice. It wasn't people sincerely going to Scripture saying, well, what does the Bible teach? It was, we're already doing this. How can I justify this behavior? And when you have that kind of procedure where you justify women speaking in church through sophisticated arguments, and this is done in the OPC and the PCA, and even the RPC and A to an extent, when you have these arguments, what you're doing is you're dishonoring Mother Church. You're dishonoring the attainments of the past. It's been done to justify heretical concepts of salvation, the covenant, corrupt worship, feminism, and false ecumenicalism, in particular, NAEPARC. The Auburn Avenue heretics, for example, present church history as being very eclectic and very... the reformers, they allowed all sorts of different views on things. Well, that's not true. The Westminster Standards are pretty clear about doctrine. They didn't say, well, we allow this and we allow that. They said, this is what the Bible teaches, period. A respect for the aged is necessary for the good aspects of historical continuity. The idea that one must turn against parents, authority figures, and the aged in order to revive culture and society is rooted in the worship of chaos and revolution as a means of grasping life and creativity. Okay, this is a distinct pagan philosophy, and it's been adopted by people, especially in the 1960s. Creativity through chaos. Creativity and advancement of knowledge through rebellion, through revolution. In the 1960s, the hippies had a slogan. I don't know if you're pretty old like me, you might remember it. Don't trust anyone over 30. Remember that? Don't trust anyone over 30. And you find it in Christian songs. Hope I die before I get old. The hatred of everything and everyone who was old was a rejection of the Christian past in favor of sloth and ethical anarchy. I mean, it's not an accident that rock stars went to Hinduism and the Maharishi and Paramahansa Yogananda and Swami Chichananda. There's a reason that these people flocked to the Eastern yogis, because they were rejecting their forefathers. They were rejecting Christianity. Now, I understand a lot of them were raised Roman Catholic, and that's easy to reject. And I understand that the Anglican Church was modernist and liberal and corrupt. But give the Bible a fair shake, sit down and read it. See what it says. It's true. A society that turns against its Christian roots, in the end, disinherits itself. It brings upon itself covenant sanctions and destroys itself. For we need these principles to live and prosper. It denies the foundation of truth, justice, liberty, freedom, and prosperity. It is not an accident that the hippie movement went hard left in support of communists and liberal Democrats or statists. It's not an accident. They did not honor what was good about our history and instead embraced Eastern mysticism, witchcraft, and lawless egalitarianism. Now, you young people, you don't remember, but in the 1960s, when they protested against the Vietnam War, they were holding communist flags. Angela Davis was a communist. The Black Panthers held communist principles. The radical left were a bunch of communists. Pinko, red diaper, doper babies. That's what they were. It's a rejection of Christianity. It's a rejection of our Christian past. It's a rejection of the achievements of Western civilization for paganism and atheism and statism and secular humanism. They did not honor what was good about our history and instead embraced Eastern mysticism. Consequently, Christian progress and godly dominion has been steadily diminished in the last 45 years in our culture and society. While technology has brought many gadgets and more comforts, the family has been seriously degraded and education has greatly declined. Talk to somebody who's a freshman in college today, get to know them a little bit, and then go back and read the letters written by farm boys from the Civil War. It's like comparing Shakespeare to Pee-wee Herman. There's been a degeneration in our culture and society because of a lack of respect for the aged and the achievements of our forefathers. You should listen to classical music. You should read history. You should learn about the past. And especially, you should learn about your Christian past. The basic and central inheritance of culture, and all that includes faith, training, wisdom, wealth, love, common ties and traditions are severed and denied where parents and elders are not honored. The tragic fact is that many parents refuse to recognize that their children have disinherited themselves. And we have to attribute a lot of this to the modernism that arose in the first part of the century. You have the rise of modernism, which predicted the Bible as the Word of God. You have the rise of fundamentalism and in a modern form of evangelicalism that rejected the study of theology and church history for a form of Christian existentialism in personal excitement, personal peace and affluence. That's the situation we're in. Let's get back to the Bible. Let's get back to our history. Let's honor the attainments of our spiritual forefathers. Let us honor our father and mother. And let us apply these principles to our lives. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for your holy word. We thank you for these principles to guide us. We ask that you would ingrain them into our minds and hearts, that we would live them. Parents and children, masters and servants, employers, employees, states, status, civil magistrates, and those under them all need these principles, Lord. Help us to be obedient. In Jesus' name, amen.